Good afternoon, and welcome to LMR Live, the Living Music Resource's unique and innovative way of providing you edutainment. The last time we were on the stage for an episode, it was pre-pandemic, March 4th, 2020, with Scraunch Music in partnership with the wonderful UM Center for the Study of Southern Culture. Today, we are partnering with them again, and I want to send a message to the universe. That event was right before all chaos broke loose with the pandemic. Today, we're partnering again with Southern Studies. Dear world, it's time for the pandemic to end, right? Can't hurt to ask, right? Right. All right. If anyone can do it, Southern Studies can do it. So we have been creative in this time, like so many arts organizations, finding virtual ways to do things, and we've been providing you with some LMR Lives via the internet in Zoom. Today, we are bringing you a hybrid version. We have our featured guests here in Nut with us, and we also have another guest joining us virtually. So you're getting a lovely hybrid. We hope you're healthy. We hope you're doing well, and we really appreciate that you're here with us. Who's ready for the music revolution to kick up again? Are you ready? It's so quiet, it's so quiet. All right, today's guests are no strangers to LMR, nor UM Music. They were featured on episode number 14 in October 2017 when we partnered with the Sarah Eisen Center for Women and Gender Studies. Something that's important to LMR are those partnerships. That's when great things happen. So, first guest, Shardé Thomas. Born in North Mississippi in 1990, granddaughter of the North Mississippi fife and drum, icon, Otha Turner. She is her grandfather's heir of the mastery of the fife and drum, and at a very young age, she's been lead vocalist, plays the fife in the Rising Star Fife and Drum Band. This group, they perform a mixture of folk music, blues, gospel, pop. Shardé released an album in 2010 entitled What Do I Do? And released her sophomore album in 2013 entitled Shoddy Blues. The Rising Star has worked with greats like Eric Clapton, Cyndi Lauper, Bobby Rush, and many, many more. Help me welcome Shardé Thomas.
Hello.
Welcome back.
Great to be back. It's great to be back.
Great to have you here. But you're not sitting on this couch alone, and I'm getting my readers on for this next one. That's different from the last time we met. Next here on the couch, you can't see him yet, but I'm going to tell you about him. Scott Barretta. Scott grew up in Northern Virginia. As a student at George Mason University and the University of Virginia, he focused his work on political sociology and did research on blues history. In 92, his doctoral studies took him to Lund University in Sweden. While there, he began writing in Swedish, I'm gonna clarify this in a second, in Swedish for the magazine Jefferson, and he became the editor. This led him to write for other publications in the United States, including The Living Blues. Fast forward. Scott came to Mississippi in 1988 to attend blues festivals and visit Clarksdale, Greenville, and other places. He met Living Blues editor and was lured in to become editor of The Living Blues in 1999. He has experienced blues firsthand. He has immersed himself into the culture and the history. He is an expert, and we are lucky to have him here today with us to share the couch and share in conversation with Shardé Thomas. Welcome, Scott Barretta!
Thank you very much.
First off, was I right about you did that in Swedish?
I wrote in Swedish, but I actually more edited a Swedish magazine. I'm fluent in Swedish. I don't think my skills in writing Swedish are very good, but I can still speak it fluently and read it fluently, even though I've been gone for 20-some years.
Wow.
I somehow picked it up.
Wow. Well, the reason we're together again, I mean, hopefully we just want to see each other, but beyond that is the concert that's happening tomorrow night in the Ford Center, The Voices of Mississippi, artists and musicians that were documented by William Ferris. That set won 2 Grammy Awards, and Scott, you wrote essays that are included in that.
Mm-hmm. I wrote an essay, a biographical essay on Bill Ferris, yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. And now it has turned into a performance event with the world premiere. happening tomorrow night at the Ford Center, yes?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Pretty exciting.
Exciting.
Yes. So first question, what does Voices of Mississippi, just those words, what does that mean to each of you?
Who wanna go first? You wanna go first?
You wanna go first? Okay. Well, I work with the set, so I guess. I attach it so much to Bill Ferris, and I've, in a lot of ways, followed in, you know, his footsteps. I don't fill his shoes by any means. But, you know, I'm the host of Highway 61, which he did. He brought Living Blues magazine to the University of Mississippi back in 1983, and then later helped create the archives. And, you know, he's worked with us on the Mississippi Blues Trail. I did a film about Mississippi Fred McDowell from the Hill Country, and Bill helped out with that, and he's always been generous. But just to get back to the voices issue, so much of the work that I do is interviewing people and presenting, you know, oral histories, you know, so it's not so much writing, well, you write around their voices, but that's right. One of the things that Living Blues has been, I think, really great at doing since 1970, you know, it's been around that long, is putting the voices of the blues at the forefront, you know, doing oral history. And I've done a lot of work like that for the Mississippi Arts Commission, but I think that's, you just learn so much when you just let the microphone roll. And that's what's kind of interesting about Bill's work as compared to other folklorists is that he just sort of had the microphone running and visited a lot of interesting people and captured just all these voices. He wasn't, some folklorists are out, can you do this? Can you do this? And they're treating it more like a recording session, but as we'll see, Bill's just a wonderful talker, right? And has this sort of a passion, which makes you feel very special when you're talking to him. It's just a natural thing. I guess it has to do with his Southern storytelling skills. But I think that's what's great, that he loved the voices that he heard out of the African-American church coming out of his, that was near his, where he grew up, down outside of Vicksburg. And so, I mean, that's something I do now. Now we're using our iPhones right. to capture the voices. That's what Bill does. If he comes around, he turns his iPhone on, he's recording everything still.
I was just blown away by his sincerity. I get what you're saying, too, when you're talking with him. You just instantly put at ease. So how about you, Shardé? What do those three words mean to you?
Well, Voices of Mississippi, like Bill, like he was saying, he wasn't just direct. It was just kind of just let it flow. And us having the opportunity to introduce Voices of Mississippi with such young artists, you know, young musicians, we have a chance to actually tell our side of the story, mm-hmm. and share it with the world. You know, share our traditions, our history, our stories, and just firsthand, just lay it all out instead of just seeing it from the older generation. You have a chance to see those voices and hear those voices from the younger generation. So I'm excited and honored to be a part of Voices of Mississippi because the world actually get a chance to hear and see the history.
Absolutely. I have a student named Cross. This question ties into what you just said. He wrote, "The music of Mississippi reflects the general circumstance, and now music can be used as historical artifact to better understand things in hindsight. Mm-hmm. Is it then possible to judge the future of a people culture based on the modern music, or rather must we rely on the historians of the future to judge our music?"
Wow.
Any thoughts on that, either of you?
That is a deep question.
It is deep. You should see him. He's great in class. If you're watching
yes.
class, he's supposed to be fantabulous.
Wow.
Whether how we can determine the music of the future from the past, is that, I mean, so.
Well, do we have to wait? Do we have to rely on the historians of the future to judge the music now? Or?
Well, that's you know, I think the thing about the analysis of music or really of anything is that we sometimes in the present don't think that we have some sort of ideology or framework. And of course, in 20 years, it's like, well, how come they were focusing on this and not this, right? So when we listen to a lot of recordings, if I think about like Bill, the fact that he left the microphone running meant that he captured a lot more because mm-hmm. sometimes You know, like if people are interviewing Shardé, they might not ask her about playing the keyboards.
Right, exactly.
Or they don't want to think about her as a modern person who listens to hip-hop or R&B.
Exactly.
Right? So that is something that I think that, you know, we tend to always, with having the voices recorded, though, we can go back and reinterpret them and create a new meaning for each generation, or not necessarily generation, but different parts of that generation.
I mean, I had a motive with that question personally, because I think a lot of music schools struggle with, you know, this idea of lifting up the past, which we need to do, you know. Western music is essential, but then how do we also incorporate and integrate the voices and the new music of today, and what then validates it as, you know, worthy? And mm-hmm. I think we're getting better with it, but it's still a work in motion.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, it seems that some people are more conscious about reaching out to that, and I can say that about the people that are on the program tomorrow night, Cedric Burnside and the Dickinsons, are all extremely conscious about connecting with the past and bringing it into the future. So it's not necessarily the past,
mm-hmm.
But you know, it's, you grew up with it. It wasn't you studying
yes.
the past, right?
No, definitely, of course not. Yeah, like you said, I grew up with it. So to me, it was just, at a young age, I was just living the dream, honestly, with my granddad. So like he said, it wasn't about the past, and now we're kind of digging up, well, not actually digging up, but we're kind of like recreating what was done years and years ago, but we're still keeping that traditional feel to it, that old school feel to it.
Mm-hmm. And developing from it.
Yes.
Right? Yeah, I think that's fantastic. Student Piper Grace, what intrigues you, Scott, about blues music? Is it the culture or the history?
Well, is there a difference?
I don't know. I'm just asking the question.
No. I'm thinking about that. What is
I'm
it?
Just asking.
Well, no, that is, there are two, I can think about that. I think that my first attraction to it was just the immersion of it. You know, when I was started listening to music seriously in my early teens, and by 16, I was going out to clubs in the Washington, D.C. area to go see artists. And, you know, I started seeing shows 3 times a week, probably when I was a teenager. And I didn't read anything, honestly. You know, I read the backs of records, but it was really when I got more into academia and I was studying politics, as you said, and somebody said, you should write about this. And then I started actually like reading Living Blues magazine and reading books. I was just too busy going out and seeing music and listening to records and partying, honestly. You know, I mean, it was, I did like to read, but I wasn't a student of it. But the history of it is what really intrigued me. Once I made a decision to study it, then I went back and just read every back issue of all the magazines, every book I could find, and then, you know, starting to reading about other genres and other music scenes. So I think, you know, I had that kind of lived experience. I didn't have the lived experience of being African American or a blues artist by any means, but the joy of the shows, you know, that kind of a thing. And then going back and then it's reading. And reading the oral histories in particular are interesting, you know, because there's no way I'm ever going to experience what it's like, you know, to be a blues musician from Mississippi, or African-American blues musician from Mississippi, but if you let people talk, you can find out a lot about that,
right.
You know, and so the history is something I've specialized in, and that's why, even though it's sad when a lot of older people die, you know, because a lot of time we get very sentimental about,
yeah.
Right, that, oh my God, this person's not here anymore.
Right.
You know, with the blues trail and other things, there's still all this material, and it's still a lot of fun to go back through and do research and to see new people get excited about it, you know. I have trouble getting excited about a lot of the stuff now because, except for her, but because I've seen so many people so many times,
right,
but
right, right.
When you see other people discovering it, it's like, wow, this is really great, isn't it?
Completely.
Yeah.
So I'm curious, Shardé, how does that transfer, you know, so Scott's hitting on the aspect of the arts appreciator, right, or the one studying it. How about when someone wants to immerse themselves and perform it? I mean, how do they make sure that it's going to be true to true to the legacy, true to the form?
Well, I would say actually doing it the correct way, you know, putting their all in it, playing their heart in it, and just letting the music move you, basically. Like, a lot of people play fife and drum music, I would say, but it's like, when I see it, it's like, it's not real, you know? It's like, they're just, hey, I'm gonna play fife and drum music, we just playing it to be planning. But with fife and drum music, you have to actually feel music, you know? You have to put your soul in it, put your heart in it, and pour it out all on the stage. So that way, your crowd, your audience, they will feel exactly what you're feeling. So that's like, you gotta put your all in it to make them feel and see what you're trying to get them to feel and see. Like, that's just like, with fife and drum music with my granddad, you know, I study him all the time watching YouTube videos, and that might be kind of funny to some people that I study my granddaddy, but I do. I'm always looking at old videos, and it's like his technique, the way he played, the way he played a certain note, or the way he moved. It was like, wow, just that swagger that he had.
But see, that's telling to me that you're still studying his videos, right? Because yes. That, in my opinion, that's the sign of a great artist, someone who is still, you know, on the road to getting better, to improving, yes. Instead of feeling like, oh, I've arrived.
No, I've got this title.
Or someone's given me this label, right?
No, ma'am. I did an interview a couple months ago, and she asked me, she said, you call yourself the Fife Master? And I was telling her, I was like, yeah, I do call myself the Fife Master. I said, but I'm always learning. I'm always studying. I'm always pushing myself to be better, to live up to that name, Fife Master. Because, right. You know, I can't have Fife Master and, you know, can't play certain songs on stage with a person. So I'm always pushing myself to do better. Or I would say, okay, that was a great show, but I could have done this better, or but I could have did this better. So I'm always pushing myself, critiquing myself to be the best.
I think that's fantastic. So tomorrow night, what do you want people to walk away with from your performance? I mean,
Actually, I haven't thought about that.
And you may not. I mean, different artists think different things, right? Some really immerse into the emotion that they're trying to convey. And then it's just up to the audience how they interpret it, right? And then I've talked with people who are very specific, like, I want them to feel blah, blah, blah. Just curious.
Oh, well, I want the audience to walk away first actually knowing about fife and drum music if they don't know about it. I want them to walk away knowing about that. I want them to walk away knowing more about the tradition part, the culture part, the history behind fife and drum music. So that's my main focus right now, to actually just have them to walk away with that. Not just, oh, they're great, oh, they did a great performance, but to actually deep down have them go home and like, okay, I need to find out more. I want to find out how she got started, or how Otha got started, or I want them to actually dive in deep.
You want to plant a seed.
Yes, plant that seed and just watch it grow.
Yeah, I like that. That's awesome. Would you be willing to play a little bit of something for us?
Yes, ma'am. What would you like to hear?
Ooh.
Certain song?
I don't know. What is it? What? Afton, do you have a request? You go.
Okay. Oh, let's see. I'm going to play Granddad's favorite song. It's a gospel song, so it's Glory. A little short version of Glory. Hallelujah. We don't have many people here in this room, but I want to take a poll. How many people is it your first time hearing that?
It's amazing, you know? And I think that's what's going to be, I love what you said, because, I mean, people are going to get a great show tomorrow night, right? They're going to get great music. But I'm trying to get teary as I say this, but you're going to plant those seeds. I mean, I think you're going to have people that just walk out and want to know more. And just so you know, here at the university, we have students studying, you know, this content in class to be prepared for what they're going to experience and to light that spark. Because, you know, we don't always know what we need, right? Sometimes it has to be brought to us. All right. Well, there's someone we need to talk about who is integral. The name has already come up in this interview, Bill Ferris. We need to talk about Bill, and he's going to be joining us remotely here in a sec. But who is William Ferris? He is widely recognized as a leader in Southern studies, African American music, and folklore. He is former chairman of the National Endowment for the Humanities. Ferris served as the founding director for the Center for the Study of Southern Culture at the University of Mississippi. Ferris has written numerous books and documentary films, most that deal with African American music and other folklore representing the Mississippi Delta. He has co-edited the Pulitzer Prize nominee Encyclopedia of Southern Culture, and as we've already mentioned, Voices of Mississippi Artists and Musicians, documented by Bill Ferris, 2 Grammy Awards. What else do I say? I'm also enthralled by his I Am a Man photographs of the Civil Rights Movement, which any of us can see at the Mississippi Civil Rights Museum. We should go on a field trip. Yes. Are you in?
You in?
We could.
Yes. Right.
I keep getting these ideas with these conversations. Okay, here's another one. We have another trip planned. All right, we are going to hear from the Bill Ferris. Bill, thank you for joining us today virtually. We're excited to talk with you about Voices of Mississippi, as well as many other projects that you have completed and are in the works with. Good afternoon.
Thank you for having me. It's an honor to be here.
When you were a young boy, what was there? Was there a pinnacle moment? Was there what drew you this direction?
Well, I was one of 5 children, the eldest of 5 on a farm. And every first Sunday, there was a church on the farm that would have services, and a lady named Mary Gordon would take me for that day. My family were happy to have one less child to deal with. And I learned at the age of 5 to sing the hymns and to love the sermons. And as I grew older, I realized that there were no hymnals in that church. And when the families were no longer there, that music would disappear. So as a teenager, I began to make tape recordings and photographs of the families and the services. And that expanded to blues and to quilt makers and writers. As I grew older, I traveled all over the state. And finally, my family thought I would never hold down a job, but I discovered by accident that you could do a PhD in folklore and get credit for what I was doing. So that allowed me to do what I loved and to find gainful employment. Quite a bit of it was at the University of Mississippi.
I love how you just encapsulated this idea of, you know, one's passion and then how it can then be purpose and also be profession. And I think that's something our students often need to hear. You know, there's certain things in life you have to do, but I like to remind my own students, listen to your own gut, what makes you tick, what really propels you forward, because that's when the great discoveries or the great outcomes occur. Would you agree?
I agree totally. And I tell my students, follow your heart, and you will be both happy and successful. And you're a great teacher, and your students are blessed to have someone who is so wise in telling them to follow what they love. And I'm guessing all music students know that, or they wouldn't be studying music.
When one chooses to do a project that it does come from this organic, true place,
it seems like it has the potential to propel further and make greater impact than just trying to be famous, trying to win the award. Was that the process in this, that it just kept unfolding and building, or early on, did you see what it was actually going to become?
No, I've never known what lay ahead, and I never knew what jobs or positions would be in my future. These two projects were more or less thrust on me by other people. Lance and April Ledbetter are these visionary music producers in Atlanta who run Dust to Digital. Mm-hmm. I've admired their work for many years and used their work in my classes. And they came to me one day and said, we'd like to do a box set of your work. And I said, I'd be honored. And neither they nor I knew that it would take 10 years and a lot of hard work by people like Scott Barretta at the university. And but that project has taken on a life of its own, especially with the accolade of two Grammy Awards that it received. And now it's a musical production, and the premiere will be next week at the University of Mississippi.
I found a quote that you said. Ferris said that the voices in the collection are interconnected, that they have a choral power. I love that, those words, yes. Because he said they all connect to both a geographic state and a state of mind called Mississippi. Well, I want to pull in some of our students because they have some great questions and they want to talk with you. I don't want to be selfish and keep you all to myself. So I'm going to ask these star students of UM Music to join us in our Zoom room.
I had a question about, why do you believe music is such an important part of retelling history and understanding history?
Well, I think, as I've said earlier, music is where language began in Africa. The first human life we know of was there. And the music was the language, the talking drum that could speak and communicate, was an important part of African and Afro-American music. We have B.B. King's guitar, Lucille. And when you see B.B. in concert, Lucille never plays when B.B. is singing, and B.B. never sings when Lucille is playing. So you have two voices there. And you hear often harmonica players will play the hounds chasing the fox. And so you hear voices in music. So I think that music comes from deep within us, and it expresses feeling, whether it's country music or gospel or blues. It has a power because it's not intellectual or something we think a lot about. It comes out of our gut. But there's no one that doesn't have a favorite song or relate to music in a special way when you talk to them. And so I see that as a key to understanding our history and our future.
I agree with that so much, Bill. I mean, I say all the time, you know, music skips the brain and goes right to the heart. Yes. And now exactly. More than ever, these young people to be performers and sharing music have such power of how they can unify people together for good. You know, thinking of the protests and thinking of the things you've covered, how does that translate in your mind to more current Black Lives Matter and the purpose that all that you've documented and sharing can serve within that sphere?
I think it connects directly with Black Lives Matter. I never knew that phrase when I did my work in the 60s, but I saw it because I was involved with civil rights work. And in Mississippi and at Davidson College, where I was an undergraduate student. And I saw recording the voices in my work as a way of protesting the fact that they were left out of our history. There were no books about these musicians, but right. by recording their stories and their music, you put them in the record. And they would often say to me, now, if we talk to you and tell you or sing this, do you promise put it out there and let people know what life was like here? And I said, I promise you that. And the box set, Voices of Mississippi, is my answer to that promise. But when I did the I Am a Man, working with my friend Gilles Morin and others, we thought of that initially as an homage to that decade and to the sacrifice of Dr. King's life 50 years earlier. We did not imagine that Black Lives Matter was coming. And what that did was fill the sails of that ship of exhibit. And it has become more important today than ever when we first began to work on it. And I am collaborating with young Black filmmakers and musicians who are using my own work as part of their work. Wow. So it's like when you preserve these photographs and recordings and films, you never know where that will lead. And, mm-hmm. you know, 100 years from now, those voices will still be heard. And, you know, there is a proverb I tell my students, an African proverb that says, when an old woman or man dies, a library burns to the ground. And these were my libraries. And by recording and preserving them, they will be forever, as Mr. Faulkner loved to say, etched on the face of oblivion. They won't be forgotten.
I noticed that you integrated the stories of really well-known Mississippians at the time, mm-hmm. but also people that weren't as well-known. So what is the importance there of kind of making an equal playing field for all the voices?
Well, all the voices are where it starts. And there are thousands of writers and musicians in Mississippi and who've been there for centuries. And a few of those become truly great. The great composer, Black composer, William Grant Still, was from Woodville, Mississippi. The greatest blues singer ever was from Itabena, B.B. King. The father of country music, Jimmy Rogers. The king of rock and roll, Elvis Presley. The great diva of opera, Leontine Price. Mm-hmm. The great writers, William Faulkner, Richard Wright, Tennessee Williams, Eudora Welty, all draw on those voices. Eudora Welty heard Fats Waller in Jackson and came back after the concert and went right to her desk and created the short story Powerhouse. So, and Richard Wright created blues songs. He wrote and composed them. And he said that the blues were the spirituals of the Black people in the city. That was the music that expressed their heart. All of this Black and white and ethnic mix of Mississippi voices is connected, if we really think about it. I think of it as an extended family. We're all kin to each other. We just don't know how those lines are drawn. But in education, as you're learning in music and in all the other fields, literature, history, sociology, art. When we look at the South and we look at Mississippi, so it seems to me that the box set is a small but significant way to do that. And one of the things I'm especially proud that it does is to transcribe the words of every song and every story from Pulitzer Prize winning writers like Eudora Welty and Alice Walker, to prison inmates at Parchman Penitentiary. They all get equal billing in that book. And you can read the language, which to me is like poetry, whether they are recognized as writers or totally oblivious to the public, all of those voices get an equal billing in that box set. And that's why I think it's all connected, and music is the key to it.
I was wondering what the conditions were like when you visited the Parchman Farm Penitentiary, and if you think the musical culture there was influenced in any way by the prison environment.
Yes, to both. The conditions were terrifying. Your life was worth nothing. You could be shot trying to escape, or no matter what happened to you, you would be buried at Parchman and no one would ever know what happened. The music was totally connected to the conditions. One of the musics that I recorded there were work chants, which are sung when you are working, hoeing cotton or chopping wood. You have a leader who sings a line, and then the gang of workers has a refrain. And that's a way of sort of pacing yourself in the midst of a hot summer day in Mississippi. If you're not careful, you will be you'll die of heat exhaustion. And this music was a way of keeping things slow but sure. It was also a way of talking about the boss man and even making fun of him in ways that he would laugh at. But if you said those things to him, you could be beaten or even killed. So music was a way of surviving terrible conditions at Parchman. And I knew about those work chants because Alan and John Lomax, the father and son, had recorded them there in the 40s. And so when I went there in the 60s, they were still being sung. And we had amazing moments as they would sing those songs while they chopped wood or were hoeing cotton in the fields. It's a very beautiful music that has roots in Africa and also inspired the blues. And it's one of the musical forms that's very close to my heart.
Well, we thank you for all of your work and dedication, and just it's beautiful to see your legacy here living on through the Center for Southern Studies. And as I said before, it's so purposeful that this concert is, the world premiere is happening in Oxford, Mississippi. We're grateful for that. But we're really on a mission of expanding the canon and purposefully recognizing where we're located and integrating, yes, you know, music of Mississippi, the birthplace of America's music, and that, yes, it is part of the standard canon.
Well, I can't tell you how thrilled I am to hear that the music department and you personally are moving in that direction, because those are the keys to the highway. Many of our great composers have built their work on the blues, on country music, Aaron Copland, mm-hmm, and others, William Grant Still, And at the University of Mississippi, you are a part of both of those great traditions of classical music and the folk sounds. And to embrace both those gives you a powerful edge. And anything I can do to help support that will be an honor. You just let me know whenever you need my support, and I'll be there.
Well, thank you. You know, in the Zoom room, we have Mississippians, and we have what I call children of Mississippi who end up being Mississippians because of this great university. And it's going to be interesting to see what the voices in this room do in the future. Well, thank you. Take care, Bill.
Bye.
Bill, thank you for joining us today.
So is your mind blown? That was such an amazing experience getting to spend time with Bill in that way. And for our students, it was so formative. All right, we are going to, in true LMR fashion, lighten things up a little bit and play a game. We are going to play Name That Tune, Voices of Mississippi Edition. Here we go. Guests have graciously agreed to go head-to-head in Name That Tune, Voices of Mississippi Edition. This is how it's going to work. I've got 8 songs over here I'm going to play a little bit of. They are going to write down on their dry erase boards what they think the title of the selection is. If they don't know, they're going to make up a title, and we're going to have a good laugh. What do you say?
Mm-hmm. Get it.
All right. Who's going to help? You're going to help keep score, Miranda? All right. Fantastic. So here is, and they're going to know these, I think, but we'll see. Here we go. Example number 1. Just a little teaser there. Very renowned, famous artist. Yes. This is unfair to you, this first one, but I thought I'm going to be really kind. And you have to make up a title if you don't know.
Oh, boy.
Anything you want. Just put anything on that board and then we'll have you turn it around. It's more fun if it doesn't go smoothly, right? It's funnier. All right, let's turn those boards around. And what is it? Shardé says we made it. Nancy, theme of Nancy. I would take it. I love the theme, but that is
right.
We Made It featuring Shardé Thomas.
I thought that's what it was. Didn't you all record together?
Yes, we did.
So pretty fun. All right, next one. All right, take a guess on those boards. All right, turn around, let's see what we got. Now That She's Gone, B.B. King, Nightlife, okay? B.B. King, I'll Survive.
Oh, okay, sounded like Nightlife.
I love it, this is so fun. Are you guys liking the music? Yes, yes.
I will survive, okay.
All right,
not the Gloria Gaynor version.
This is fun. Easy for me, I'm just sitting here. He did say the title.
Oh.
He did say the title. It's a little hint, a little hint. Any idea on the artist? Yes, Cedric Burnside. Yes, the title, we'll take it. We'll call that a draw. We'll call that a draw. So that was I'm Hurtin'.
I'm Hurtin'.
You guys are, this is good. All right, next up. This was, again, a little easier for Shardé. A little easier. Take a guess. All right, go ahead, flip it around. Need to be free. Yes.
No Mississippi All-Star.
Oh, yeah.
What did you write down? What were you inspired?
Oh, yeah. That was.
Even if you draw an emoji.
Well, they do so many collaborations, I was never sure who it was. I know they.
Yeah, they do.
They do an awful lot of music. Okay.
It's awesome.
I think she won.
We're going to do, how about two more? Two more.
Okay.
You told me, baby, once upon a time. You said if I would be yours, you would sure be mine, but that's all right.
Any idea on the artist, anybody?
Nope.
Anybody? Nope. Okay, let's see the titles. Yep. Oh, that's all right, Jimmy Rogers. That is right. Good guess, Be Mine, but that.
Thought it was Muddy. That's probably Muddy playing on it, though.
Ah! Get that one for Scott, Miranda. He gets a point there. All right, last one.
I walk 47 miles of barbed wire. I use a cobra snake for a necktie. I got a brand new house on the roadside, made from rattlesnake hide. Made on top, made out of a human skull. Now come on, take a little walk with me, Arlene, and tell me who do you love?
I went a little too long there. All right, what do you think it is? I'm gonna start doing this in class. Pass out dry erase boards and have like
name
it this way. Who do you love? Yes. Bo Diddley, who do you love? Excellent.
I couldn't think of it for nothing. I forgot it.
They went, you get a trophy. Everybody gets a trophy. All right, we'll call it a draw. But if that doesn't have your toe tapping and you're not moving your seat, please take your pulse. There's something wrong with you. All right, we are going to wrap things up. I want to thank all of our LMR supporters and partners, our loyal viewers via the web, the College of Liberal Arts, the Department of Music, the University of Mississippi Center for the Study of Southern Culture, very specifically Katie McGee, and Afton Thomas. They are phenomenal forces of nature. I want to thank our Giving Society, the Secret Salon Society. Feel free to contact me or Brady Bramlett about joining it. I want to thank our team that makes up LMR, Executive Managing Director Brady Bramlett, Graduate Assistant Miranda Shapiro, and our undergraduate assistants Alexis Rose, Emma Johnson, and John Christian Simmons. We look forward to seeing you on October 30th for our next LMR Live in partnership with the Sarah Isom Center, where we will be talking with Kelly Hogan and Jenny Conley. The music, research, revolution continues, and let's give it up for these two and Bill Ferris. Woo!